Good, we're about to discuss it. Okay. Let's have a look. Rafa'enu. Rafa'enu is to ask Hashem for a healing. A healing. Once again, it's in the plural because it is possible and recommended to pray for other people who are sick and even to pray for yourself. But wait a minute. That makes no sense. Because Hashem is the... Oh, God bless you. Hashem is the one who made us sick in the first place. So why are you praying to God to heal a sickness when He obviously wants you to be sick?
Wait, why?
Does that make sense? Is that a fair question? Yeah. That's a fair question. It's not my question.
Wait, why is it in the plural?
Why is... Well, the plural is we're praying for each other. I think the plural means we're praying for ourselves and for other people. My question is, though, God made you sick, right? Tough noogies. That's what God wanted. And by the tough noogies is not part of the bracha. Right? But that's, you know, is that expression America, tough noogies as well?
Yeah. No. Yeah.
Well, it is now.
Okay. Rabbi, I have an answer.
Let's get the question down, first of all. Because the question may be better than the answer. We're in the Siddur.
But we're not. We're
no, we're in the Siddur still. Remember from last class, we skipped the first part of the Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam shehakol nehyeh bedvaro.
Amen.
Oh my goodness. What's hot? It's like the surface of the sun. What?
I told you to.
Woof.
A cup of hot water.
Yeah.
I have tea bags. You want?
What tea do you have?
Green tea. You want some?
What flavor?
What's up?
Green.
What do you got? That looks suspicious.
No, it's good. But I actually, when I was, I brought it in my suitcase, and my bag got taken into checking, and she's like, I thought there was drugs in your suitcase.
Okay, I don't have to hear about your drugs in the suitcase, honey. It's okay.
It was just
I'm not...
tea. She was cracking up.
Thank you. It's very kind of you. Thank
of
you.
Of course, I was keeping on me. Good for you.
Yes, it is. Right.
Does it smell bad? What do you think I would give you?
No, it's definitely. I'm not judging your green tea. Thank you.
I got you. Give a little flavor.
Okay, a little something. Okay. So, Rafaeli, so why do we pray to Hashem to take away our illnesses? Why don't you get in the first place? Yes, Anya.
Ooh, I think because when you pray for someone, you change, like I don't know if it's the same for other people, but like when you daven for something, don't you become a new person? So it's like the new decree, new person type thing. I don't know if it works the same way with like if I daven for you, I change who you are. I don't know if that it goes that far.
It's a good answer. Where do we see in the Torah someone praying for someone else?
Every story.
Moshe Rabbeinu prayed for his sister. That is the shortest prayer in the entire Torah. Kel narafan Allah. Please God, heal her. So the idea of praying for someone else to get healed is good. Why does she get sick in the first place?
She's speaking Lashon Hara.
About?
Moshe.
Moshe Rabbeinu. So Moshe Rabbeinu himself was the one being spoken about. He still prayed for his sister to have a refua shelema. He kept it short prayer so people wouldn't think there is any form of favoritism. So he kept it short, but it worked, and she healed. So Hashem gave the makkah, but he also gave the refuah. Part of the refuah for us, the Jewish people, is prayer. You go to the doctor, right? Rofei Rofei, we know that there's a mitzvah to go to a doctor and to get the correct medical treatment. But in addition to that, we pray. Actually, you can go as far as to say that maybe Hashem gave the sickness in the first place. Because, Sila, do you mind closing the door, please? I'm sorry, my dear. Maybe I should give the disease in the first place because he wanted you to pray. Which is why the Gemara says that any form of pain, you get a pain in your back. You should pray to Hashem for it. You shouldn't say, well, I've got a pain in my back. That's what Hashem wants. There's no point in praying. It could well be that that sickness came upon the person because Hashem wanted them to pray for that healing anyway. Because prayer is not just a means to an end. It's an end in and of itself. Who else prayed for somebody else who was sick, who had actually a very weird, unusual disease that has never occurred ever since in the Torah? We're actually going to learn another concept from this one story. I think we mentioned it once before in this class. We'll mention it again.
Oh, Yosef.
He did? Who did you pray for? Yosef.
Abraham
prayed for Avimelech. Remember, Avimelech had a... Because he kidnapped his wife, Sarah. He had a disease that blocked up every single orifice in his body. Ouch. And Avraham Avinu, although he could have allowed him to die, probably would have been, you know, understood for him to do that, he prayed for him to get better. And what do we say from that? What do we learn out from this very important prayer, a very important concept in Jewish thought and prayer in general, is that if you pray for somebody else, you get answered first. Nana Tchila, his wife, was able to get pregnant after all these years, right? So her, quote unquote, orifices were opened through bracha by having a child, and that was triggered by him praying for Avimelech's orifices to open as well. You pray for someone else, you answer us. You had to hand up first. For prayed for Avimelech to have full healing. And Rashi says over there that he was answered first by his wife getting pregnant. Yeah.
The question was, why are we asking God to heal us if he needs?
Why are we asking God to heal us when he gives the makkah, the chol in the first place?
Okay, so I understand why we're asking that here, but it's like that in all the other brachos also. So why does, like, if God made us dumb, why would he ask for wisdom?
Yeah, I guess, yeah, the same principle applies to everything else. Right? Hashem gives us some, but wisdom you can grow in, right? Hashem makes us, you know, as we're born, and then we grow in wisdom, you know? And teshuvah is based upon us. Here, it's like a direct, Hashem made us sick. We believe Hashem gives us all sickness, comes from Hashem. So we're saying, then why bother praying at all? And the answer is, because the sickness could have come in order. I mean, it definitely is for us to pray for healing from the sickness, right? People get upset with this, by the way. See, why would God, you know, make people suffer, right, in the world? And the answer is, so we can have an opportunity to help other people. One of these, we help other people, is also to pray for them. That's part of the healing. We see that as a major part of the process. Yeah? Yeah. God bless you. God bless you.
Thank you.
When we pray for others and our prayers are answered first, doesn't like Hashem, like Hashem knows exactly what we're getting at. Like, by
once again, okay, that's it. It says a little, and you're saying disingenuous, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The answer is, so what?
What do you mean, so what?
I do a lot of disingenuous things that are still good. I say thank you to people. Do I really mean it? I still got to do it. It's a win-win. They benefit, and the prayer benefits as well. What do you care? Like, I don't know, you prayed for me. I don't, you were just doing it for yourself. I'm like, great, you win, I win.
It's a like proper intent.
Why not? Good intent. I'm going to get something good out of it, you get something good out of it. It's a win-win situation. It's beautiful. Nothing wrong with it.
Two birds, one stone.
Mm. Okay. Yeah, nothing wrong with it. Yeah.
That can't be the only answer, right?
That can't be the only answer. I guess not. Why, you have another answer?
No, just because, like, that doesn't always happen. Person that's sick doesn't always get healed.
No, does not. And back again, because it's not always a means, it's an ends and of itself. The prayer itself should be said. That's therefore, a person gets sick, I mean, not everyone gets better, people die, right? And a lot of them have sickness, we understand. But there's something to be said that the prayer itself is something. So Hashem is giving an opportunity to pray for someone else or for ourselves. You could pray for yourself if you're sick, right? And the short answer is because Hashem wants to hear prayers. Doesn't mean he's going to, but Hashem wants to hear our tefillot. It's one of the things Hashem wants from us to do is to pray. Okay? Because itself, what does that mean to pray? To build a connection with Him. To build a connection. You see many stories of people who everyone prayed for and the person didn't get better. Well, wasted prayers. We say, no, those are not wasted prayers. Those prayers achieve something. We don't know what exactly and in what way, but the prayers themselves change people's lives. Maybe a person who was a secular person, maybe a religious person who was lacking faith, that prayer changed who they are. Maybe the desired end, Hashem decreed that a person should die, but he wants other people to. Maybe the merit of all that prayer is actually accrued to the person who is sick, who ends up dying anyway. Who knows? We don't know how it works. We don't know how the Hashem's full accounting, right? But you still pray.
Often the opposite happens, though. Like, if someone gets sick, then that turns them away from God.
It could do, yeah. People still have free will. People still have free will to be manifested. Yeah, it could be.
So that kind of defeats the purpose.
It's up to every individual. Hashem doesn't change our minds. Emuna has to come from the person. But yeah, it could be people go through suffering and lose their emuna, right? It could well be, yeah.
So you know how, like, I don't know if it's going to be in this New York. I know it's in like my art scroll, for sure. But like, there's that part where interfering, you can like add names.
Yeah, so at that point, yeah, there are many sidurim you'll say an extra supplication if you wish that a person, okay, you mention the person's name,
but
if you want.
Ask a question about it or not yet?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so you know how it says, like, it's like the Yehiratzon thing, and you like you say that, and then you like you add the name. And
yeah.
Then, so after you say one name, can you just go on and like add another name? And
yeah,
like,
you can catalog them.
You can just go name by name by name. You don't have to like restate the whole thing.
Boop. Yeah, and
but
always
like,
in the name of, when it comes to a sick person, you pray in the name of the
mother.
Okay.
Right, as my wife always says, because when you're sick, you go to your mommy. That's how to remember that one.
Wait, where do you put in the name?
So
before
I mean the
Yehiratzon or after, like
the,
after
that is
Yehiratzon.
Well, before the Sephardi, Sephardi doesn't actually mention names over here. I don't know.
Okay.
I stopped it in the Gerusa. Ashkenazim do, but you probably can as well inside the Yehiratzon.
But what do you mean inside?
After,
like, when do I mention it? When do I not?
Yehiratzon for Nachashem again. When I was in, you're praying for Shleima, and you can mention the names. No, this is Sephardic one. Sephardic one. They don't leave a gap over there.
Oh no, that's so sad.
Yeah.
So then when do you do it?
Yeah, when do you do it?
I'll be honest with you, I don't.
I
mention sick people later on, actually, before the final tefillah. If you actually look at the words over here, this section is actually praying for yourself to be healthy.
If you're davening for yourself and you're saying that you give that song, you just say your name.
Yeah.
Like you would say anyone else's.
Yeah. Actually, for teshuva as well. Right. You say Hashem should accept teshuva of whatever your Hebrew name is, but Ben or Bat's your mother's name, yeah. Okay, so that's Rafa'enu. Okay, so we have, so notice we start with the spiritual, right? And then the physical, we start with the Hashivenu, the Selachna, look at our afflictions, and then the afflictions become physical, and that's Rafa'enu. Okay, and then we come to Parnasa. This is the Parnasa Bracha, and this changes, we actually change this Motzi Shabbat. Right, we moved for Ashkenazim, we moved into B'tein Talamata Levracha. So for Ashkenazim, they just changed one line. For Sephardim, they changed the entire bracha. It goes from Barachenu to Barach Aleinu, and the entire bracha, or contents of the bracha changes. This is for Panasa, so a very special bracha. Why does it...
Aleinu now?
Mm-hmm. What?
That
yeah, yeah.
Wait, what's the difference?
Wait,
what
where is that?
Sfano actually changed the entire, I think Hasidim to do from Barachenu in the summer to Barach Aleinu in the winter.
Oh.
Okay, but the same thing, Tein Talam Atar is inside the Bracha. So the main part of it is the Tein Talam Atar, right? And that changes. Why does that change over here? What is this, what are you praying for?
Really?
Why does it change in December? Why is it an English date? Because it goes to the winter solstice, okay? Because this is actually for Parnasa in Chutz La'aretz. In Chutz La'aretz. So that's why it changes by the English date. I think in Eretz Yisrael it's earlier. Okay?
Wait, can you hold on 1 second? I'm still writing all of that down.
Okay.
Yeah, why?
So I'll, okay.
The English date is because...
Because the winter solstice.
But that's not the winter solstice. December 4th isn't.
December 5th
December
is,
21st.
Yeah.
No, it's December 21st.
So, but look,
it's the
first night of the civil year through the December event is recited during the winter. So this is when the winter officially begins.
Mm-mm.
For a civil leap year from Arvid of December 5th through Mincha Pesach.
I never know which one I'm supposed to say.
Mine says December 4th.
So it depends whether it's leap year or non-leap year. December 4th or 5th.
Okay,
right. It actually changes depending on the year itself.
What?
But that doesn't make sense because...
I'm so confused.
Because
okay,
that's not winter solstice.
Okay.
Winter solstice is
so
December
I guess 25th. It's considered when the winter begins is December 5th. December 4th or 5th.
So which one do we say now?
Right now you change to V'tein Talam Atar Levracha.
That's what I should be saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Wait, so we're asking Hashem here not for Israel, but for...
Yes.
For Israel?
No. You said not for Israel. I
not,
said yes.
Okay.
You said not for Israel. I said yes. Which means... Not for Israel. So
but why not for Israel?
Because Israel already did change.
So by changing according to like America's schedule.
We say, slow down 1 second. Anya? So in Israel we did change it. And that's when we changed from Morid Atal to Mashiach Baruch Hu Morid Geshem. And that is earlier, or the first part of the Amidah, which changed during Sukkot.
Oh, okay.
So that actually is for Eretz Yisrael.
Okay.
We want the rains to come at different times, right? From Shmini Atzeret, end of Sukkot, we change to that one. So that's actually Pharisee Strong. And then it all changes back with the new year of Pesach. On Pesach, everything flips back together. Okay, so that's actually that. So that's why Baruch Aleinu goes with the beginning of the winter, December 4th or 5th, depends on the leap year or not. And that's how it changes. Yeah? So let's have a look at the words. Let's see what we're saying. Okay, so we're saying, well, let's do the, it is winter. Let's do the, well, actually, this is a Sephardic one. So Baruch Aleinu Hashem Elokeinu Tashana Zot. Right, we ask God to give us all the good crops, the tova, the tain talu mata levracha. We ask Hashem to give us the rain, levracha. Why? Rain is bracha, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, obviously not necessarily, if we're saying God give us rain for bracha, because
we want things to grow.
Yeah, well, that grows because you have rain. But why would it say rain for bracha? It's obvious. If you're giving rain, you have bracha. No, things don't grow without rain. Remember the answer to that? Very famous Gemara on this. And the answer is that maybe rain could come and give you klala. Too much rain. It's floodings. Right? You can have rain, right, that is too much. And we learn that from a story of Chani Mendoza, right? And sorry, Choni Hamagel. Not Chani Mendoza. Choni Hamagel. Choni the circle maker. There was not rain in Eretz Yisrael. And he made a circle around him and said, I'm not leaving here until we get rain. It started to rain, but it was too much. And started to flood. You don't want too much rain. You want just the right amount. So you want to have Tein Talo Matar. You want precipitation. But you want Labracha and not La Klala Chas V'Chalila. God willing. Okay? Al Kol Pnei Adama, on the entire world. Bereva Pnei Tevel. We ask Hashem to Mali Adeinu Birchatecha, fill our homes with Osher. So this is actually the Bracha for Parnasa. So even if you do not own a field, well, you benefit from the crops of the field, but you're asking Hashem to really give you Parnasa. Okay? And you want the Bracha of the rain to come and enter your home. And Baruchat Hashem, Mevarech Hashanim. So if you want more money in your lives, or you want to pray for your families who support you, because you're students, this is a good bracha to say for your parents. Okay? Okay. And you finish off, Mevarech Hashanim, he blesses the years. Okay, so now we go from the individualistic, although it's still pluralized, to a whole different area. There's a switch in the Amidah that's about to begin. Okay? There's a switch in the Amidah that's about to begin. And I'll just mention that each of them, we didn't really do much of this, we should have done a bit more of this, we did a little bit. Each bracha follows the one after it, or the one that precedes it, because there's some connection between them. We now go from bracha to teka b'shofar, sounding a shofar. What shofar is this? Teka b'shofar gadol. Not just a shofar, a big one. One of those big Yemenite ones that they, you know, play next to the kotel. What shofar are we talking about? Meital. What shofar are we talking about?
Mashiach.
Oh, good girl. Right, so now we went from individual salvation, remember, asking for teshuvah, asking for personal health, right, and from the individual to the klal. So you start with the trees, and now we're going to talk about the forest, if you will. You go from the individualist, and now we're going to talk about the coming of Mashiach and the final redemption. And the rest of the Amidah is actually going to be on that topic. Okay? So tika b'shofar, God, let there be a great shofar call. Lecheruteinu. What's chirut? Freedom is correct. Vesa nes. And let there be a nes. What's a nes? Ah, not over here, it's not. No, over here it's not. It's connected, obviously, because it's the same word. But a nes is actually a banner or a flag. Why would the same word for a banner or a flag be a miracle? Because when a miracle is performed, it's like a flag is being put down and said, this is conquered territory. Okay? So actually the word nes means a miracle, but really it means, as we see from here, a banner or a flag. So we're asking God to allow there to be a nes, a banner, that's going to lekabet guluyotenu, to what's kabet from the word kibbutz, gather together all of the Jews from Galut. So we've been doing great in Chutz La'aretz, right? Which is why the Baruch Aleinu comes beforehand. That's money outside of Israel. Actually, in addition to inside Israel. And now we're like, great. So we have everything. Now we want Hashem to redeem us, right? Because all of our woes, all of our challenges, health and spiritual and financial, comes because we're in Galut. So we want to end Galut. So now the rest of the Midah is about ending Galut. And that's going to begin with the sounding of, well, we're actually asking Hashem to sound the shofar that's going to gather the exiles. So the gathering of the exiles, kibbutz galiot, I mean, arba kanfot ha'aretz, nidchei Yisrael, gather the Jewish people, as the prophet Isaiah tells us, from all four corners of the earth, is a prerequisite to the Mashiach's arrival. Okay. So now we're talking about Mashiach coming. But first of all, we get the Jews back, because he's kind of a king who turns up as the Mashiach and says, hello, I'm the Messiah. And like, hey, where are my subjects? Where do Jews be at? Cricket, right? No Jerusalem, no. So Jerusalem's going to have to fill up, as we're going to see in a second. And Israel's going to have to fill up. And we have to have a lot of Jews. So he turns up, he's like, ah, I'm a king, I have a kingdom, and I have subjects. Oh, that's us, by the way, the Jewish people. Okay, so that is a prerequisite to Mashiach's arrival. So that's where we start with Kibbutz Galiot. And the shofar could be a literal shofar, but it's a call, a loud call that's going to gather the Jewish people together. It was funny, I was driving with my kids. You know, they have these like sirens they test sometimes, the nuclear sirens they test, because we're near Indian Point, which is a nuclear facility. So they sound the sirens. My kids are like, ah, is Mashiach coming? They get very excited. I said, not yet. A nuclear bomb is. The sun needs to come in. Chas v'shalom. The kabseinu, mehira, gather us together, yachad, together, mi arba, kanfot. That's a literal verbatim quote from the prophets, to gather us from the four corners of the earth, la'arseinu, to our land, which is not Miami, it is Eretz Yisrael. Kibrot Hashem, mekabetz, who gathers together, nidchei, the dispersed, amo, Israel, right? Jewish people, to the land of Israel. Okay, so now we're like, you know what? It's not just about you and you, it's about us. Go from the I into us, the me into we. Yeah? All right. So what would come after? Oh, one of the commentators says, we know that when Mashiach comes, or the gathering comes together, it'll be a time of financial success for the Jewish people. Right? That's why these two brachot are put next to each other. You go from financial success to the redemption of the Jewish people. And that's because it'll be a time, either a time of year or a time of history when Jewish people are doing well financially. And you thought, aren't Jews always doing well financially? No, I don't think so. Yeah.
We're going to have to know the reasons why, the reasons for the order.
If I mention it and it's got relevance, then yeah. But I won't be so specific, I don't think. But it's still worth knowing. Okay, next bracha is going to be related to this whole messianic thing. What's the next bracha? Hashiva shofteinu kevarishona, v'yotzeinu kevatchila. Hashem, please restore justice. Really? What's that talking about? As it used to be? What, there used to be justice and now there isn't?
Restore
memenu tzarav yagon malacha. And remove from us all these the sinners that are with us, umloch aleinu, and be a king over us. Quickly, levadcha, you yourself, b'chesed, because you judge us with chesed and rachamim, b'tzedek, justice, mishpat, and judgment, brachas Hashem, melech, ohev, because God, you love tzedakah or mishpat. What's this talking about? What are you praying for when you pray for this? We know it's got to do with Mashiach, because that's the track we're now on, the end of history. Anyone?
I think it's about the Beit Din.
Yeah, right, the Sanhedrin. We want the Sanhedrin to be reformed, don't we? Actually, it's going to be the Sanhedrin who are going to be the ones who actually appoint Mashiach and then allow the prophet to anoint him. So we're going to have a court of Jewish law set up, Kavur Roshona, as it used to be, because there used to be a Sanhedrin, right? It's the 71-member court of the Jewish people. They had, among them were prophets and great people, and they're the ones who had the ability to anoint the Mashiach. So before we even get going in this whole messianic drama, at some point we're going to have the Haifani Musidor, by the way. You check it out, it's good?
Yeah.
Enjoying it?
Yeah.
We're going to have this whole restitution of justice. And up to now, I mean, we have justice now, but what justice are we basing ourselves upon? Bet Din and the justice of other countries and other lands. We don't want that because they didn't always act with chesed, right? You don't want another nation. You don't even want a malach, chas v'chalila, judging you, right? Because they just go with lefnim mishrat adin. Whatever the law says, it's done. Hashem is chesed. He's rachamim, right? It's like your mother. I didn't mean to burn down the house. You still love me. Right? I didn't mean to spend all our money. I didn't mean to come, you know, whatever. So we ask Hashem to come back because we see the Sanhedrin as really a continuation of HaKadosh Baruch Hu's control of this world. And that's what we want to come back. So that's also part of it. So if the Jews come back, because you can't have a Sanhedrin if there ain't no Jews, right? And you can't have Mashiach, be Mashiach till you have a Sanhedrin. So there's a piece over here. So we want good judges and judgment that come with this entire production for the Jewish people. However, comes in the 19th bracha, which we spoke about already. V'lamal shinim al titikva. V'lamal shinim, there are people, there are heretics, we have to define what that means, but there are individuals within our own people who unfortunately stand against us. And they have done since Roman times. I know we try to think of it's us versus them, but sometimes among us, you remember even the Hanukkah story? You know, it's Greeks versus Jews. Even that's not accurate. Even that's not accurate. There were Greeks and Jews, and there were Greek Jews. Right? There were Hellenists who assimilated. And it's hard to believe that a Jew could actually go against their own people, go against the land of Israel, going against Torah mitzvot, but just imagine such a thing as possible, and that's what we're dealing with. Yeah.
Can you, sorry to go back, but the for Stefa Mishpat, what is the justice that we're
asking HaKadosh Baruch Hu to bring justice to the world? Right. We don't want to have justice coming and meted out by you know, random people and other nations. Right, we want the justice to come from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. One of the reasons is Hashem is more lenient. His justice is fairer. Hashem sees every nuance and is able to give us a fair shake. So we want that justice. But really you're praying for the Sanhedrin to be reestablished because they are the ultimate judging body, and it's connected to Mashiach coming because you're going to have the Sanhedrin in order to have a Mashiach. Yeah, it's a key part of that. So now we're saying there are individuals who work against us. These are heretics. I want to define that because there's a big discussion. Do we really have heretics today? You'd have to be very, very learned, right? I mean, the average, like, you know, 15-year-old kid, I don't believe in God. He's not a heretic. He's an idiot. He doesn't know anything, right? He doesn't learn about Judaism, doesn't know Torah, doesn't know mitzvah. What does he know? He's a tenek shenishba, right? Even a lot of quote-unquote rabbis out there who think they, you know a lot of stuff, unfortunately don't. So this is talking about people who really knew their stuff and acted against the Jewish people. There were many such people in Jewish history. So we say, this. Who wrote this bracha? What was his name?
Gamliel II, the Nasi of Israel.
Right,
of
he appointed, I think, Shmuel HaKatan. Didn't he to do this one against the heretics? He was actually authored this particular prayer, didn't he? I think we said that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was in his days, but he appointed Shmuel HaKatan. And why was he Katan? Not because he was short, he was a very humble individual. Because this is a big thing. Asking Hashem to take action against Jews. Not so simple, okay? For them, there shouldn't be any hope, right? And V'chol oivech v'sonechem heirepetu, they should be disconnected. Okay, we don't ask them to die. U'malchot harasha, and these other bad nations that we're under, whether run by non-Jews or Jews actually, Meira Ta'ker Shabeh, they should be broken, Utchalem, Utachniem, and they should be destroyed. Bimhera V'yameinu, Shovel Evim Umachnia Zedim or Minim. There's different opinions whether it's sinners or heretics. Okay?
What's the difference? Like, you're a heretic, you're a sinner. They go hand in hand.
No, not necessarily. Some people sin without being heretics. I do a lot of sins. I don't think I'm a heretic.
Can one be a heretic and not necessarily be sinning?
Nah, you're probably if you're, it's like fins and scales. If you've got scales, you definitely got fins. I think if you're there, you're probably sinning if you're a heretic.
I mean, is it being a heretic a sin?
Yeah, I'm saying it goes.
But like, what if somebody just like, they keep all the halachos and stuff, but like they do it because they know they have to, but in their hearts, they just can't come to the belief. Like,
still worth doing it, and there's still some belief. If they don't, it's unusual.
Like
but
an atheist.
Who just does it out of...
Because they
like, I don't know, like their parents might make them or like something like that. Like they don't really have a choice or like...
So what's your question?
I don't know. Like, that, like, are they really committing a sin just because they have the ideology they have?
No. Right. Right. Through their actions, they may actually come eventually to believe and it's still
that's
worth
true.
Doing.
Like,
and halakha is, even if they do not believe, they should still do because eventually through your actions, you will come to believe as well.
Okay, bet.
Even through your prayer, as we said, David HaMelech, Emantik Yadaber, as we said in Halal over Hanukkah, the more you speak, it will change you as well. Okay? So that's them. So now we have brought the Jews back. We're being told there's going to be heretics in Israel before Mashiach comes. That's why it's still there. Right? That wasn't a prayer that was made as a short amount of time. That prayer was added for the Jewish people, right, throughout history. That means this is going to be a constant and consistent problem for our people throughout Jewish history, that they actually implement, stuck it in the full-time Amidah. Big thing. Shemona Esrei became the Shei Esrei, you know what I'm saying? It's a big, big deal. Okay? Now we're like, fine. So they're gone. Right? We pray to Hashem they should be wiped out. Now we're like, aha.
But they said pray for that. We don't pray for them to die.
No. To be their ideas and their beliefs should. Okay. Actually, it's a very famous Gemara with Rabbi Meir. He was actually, used to be beaten up. And, you know, persecuted by certain heretics. And he prayed for them to die. And his wife Bria said, don't do that. She said, you pray for them to do teshuvah. He said, you know, you're right. He did. And they did. And they became great tzaddikim. All right? And if that happened now, I'll be like, that's the greatest miracle ever. But yes.
Well,
I'll have to, yeah.
I kind of have a question about that.
Yeah.
There's people in all types of communities that, like, they're good Jews, but they may not be good people. They do horrible things.
Okay, then they're missing half the entire Torah. The Torah has been unlamakom and been unlamakom.
But they seem like they
We're living in a world of sheker. It's much harder to... Yeah, it's a problem.
So, but are the... Like, those people are considered heretics?
I don't believe so. They're considered sinners. Ala tzadikim. Now let's talk about the tzadikim. And the chassidim. That doesn't mean the chassidim that we know with fairy hats, you know, and the bekishes and the rest of it. Because that... from the 1600s, right? So Chassid Rishonim, we actually mentioned that the great people, Chassid Rishonim used to pray for, remember that we said he used to pray for hours and hours and hours every single day, okay? So basically the Chassidim we have nowadays are borrowed terms from these individuals. The Asherim Chobei Yisrael and the rest of the Jewish people, the Azaknaim, if you want to add the elders, the Alpleta Sofrim and the remaining scholars among us, the Algeria Tzedek and the righteous converts who would consider part of our people, right? We ask Hashem to bless them because in their merit we're going to pray and bring a redeemer. I mean, that's part of it, right? We want Hashem to protect our great individuals, right? We want Hashem to give them their chelek. They shouldn't be embarrassed. And Hashem should take care of the righteous people because we know the righteous people have a great benefit, not just to themselves, but to everyone else. Right? And we know you can pray. By the way, it's a weird thing. Think about it. Why are you praying for righteous people? So you have a non-righteous person, which, you know, most people are praying for righteous people. Hello, does that work? If they're righteous, what do they need me to pray for them?
To remain.
But they'll pray for themselves. What do they need
to me? To, like, gas them up to God.
To what?
To, like, gas them up, like, you know, like, be like, oh, look at all these, like, you know, like, Look at these awesome Jews.
Why do I need to say that?
Well, because you're like, look at these awesome Jews. Like, I'm sort of related to them. Look at these people in their merit.
You're going to have to say, whether you like it or not, and the Gemara does say this, that we don't know who they are always. And everyone's got to make this prayer because Hashem takes every prayer seriously. And it could well be that we need these individuals, but their merit could come from the people. We know that a prophecy only comes from a prophet who's in Israel, who is feeling the kedusha of the land and the people who are there. Meaning, don't let the bracha of an ordinary person, the word hediot, actually the word idiot comes from the word hediot, an ordinary individual, right? It's not a pejorative term, should take effect. So you get a bracha from a tzaddik, it's a good thing. But make no mistake, you get a bracha from an ordinary individual, could be a great thing as well. Who knows? Only Hashem knows. So us praying for them to have, it could be that they need our prayers. And they must need our prayers, or it wouldn't be any doubt for the rest of us. We just say, okay, and this is said by tzaddikim. Only tzaddikim says prayer, but we don't say that. We say everyone makes this prayer. So prayers of every individual are considered to be kadosh, and who knows who's a tzaddik and who isn't, or a tzaddiket.
But it says also here that it says on the righteous converts and on ourselves.
Yeah. Oh, because righteous people may be saying this prayer as well.
But I'm still a little confused why we daven for the righteous people.
Because they need our prayers, obviously. Okay. Don't think that any one person who's righteous can maintain their own holiness. It takes the rest of us too. It takes a village. Or in this case, a nation. Okay. So now we have that. So we have
wait a second. I just need to write.
Sure, sure. So let's go back. So now we sounded the shofar. Jews coming back. Now we said, fine. Bring back the Sanhedrin. Because we need a Sanhedrin. Because the Jews are back. We're going to have a Sanhedrin. Then we're like, by the way, the heretics, they're going to try to cause trouble for us before the end of days. We're going to get rid of them. Then we're like, but the righteous people, we need them to stand up, right? We need to pray for them too. They should be successful, including Mashiach, by the way. Yeah, and Mashiach ben Yosef. Now we're like, let's get inside Israel and let's build Yerushalayim. Ooh, things just got real. Tishgon betoch Yerushalayim. We want you, Hashem, to dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. Ircha, this is your city. Kashedi Barata, that you spoke about. V'chisei David, and the seat of King David. Wow, you just mentioned King David. What's the seat of King David? That doesn't literally mean the throne. Actually, it includes the actual throne. But it means that the center of Jewish power and Jewish kingship is going to be in Yerushalayim, in Jerusalem, the holy city. Okay? And may the seat of King David, because you know Mashiach has to be a direct descendant of King David. I know this has become a Mashiach class, but that's what we're asking for, yeah? We don't even think of, people read this, most people read this are like, yeah, I'm just praying for King David. Don't pray for King David. Pray for King David's descendant, Mashiach, to come and redeem us, right? At the end of days, where we are right now, by the way. Yeah? As we say in Tehillim every single day, Bone Yerushalayim Hashem, God, you are the builder of Israel. King David says in Psalms, Nidche Yisrael Yekanes, you're going to enter the Jewish people into the land of Israel. So the building of Jerusalem goes hand in hand with the return of the Jewish people to Israel, which makes sense, and the arrival of Mashiach. And the arrival of Mashiach. So this whole return to Jerusalem, and actually Rashi on that piece of Tehillim even says, when you see Jerusalem is being built up and it is packed, and you can't, you know that, you walk around and it's so tight and you're squeezing around, you know, Machane Yehuda Erev Shabbat. He says, when you see that happening, and you see that Jerusalem is full of throngs of Jews, which is a relatively recent thing, historically speaking, you know the redemption is at hand. One of the signs Mashiach is actually coming is the real building of Yerushalayim. So the two go hand in hand together. Yeah.
So it makes sense that Bnei Yerushalayim is here, but why is it like in Birkat Hamazon and?
Because we always remember, very good. So every food we have, we remember Yerushalayim and the destruction, because the food doesn't taste as good, and we want to be celebrating and eating bread in Eretz Yisrael together with Mashiach. All connected to the same thing. Very, very good. Yeah.
Okay, so I just want to think really weird. Right now we're talking about in Yerushalayim how like we want Israel to be restored. Right, yes. Before that we talked about how we need the judges, and then before that is the shofar. But it's going out of order, because the first thing that needs to happen is Israel needs to be like restored, then the judges come back, then they bring Mashiach. So why does it go shofar,
well, they
judges?
Well, let's go. Shofar Israel means we need Jews in the land of Israel, because you can't have a Sanhedrin without Jews in Israel.
But
Jews too in Israel.
To have a shofar, my question, because you do to have a shofar, you say sound the shofar, we're coming in like the Jews want to come into Israel, Mashiach, whatever. But that's at the moment where right when they in my like knowledge, but once the shofar sounded, like Mashiach's entering the room.
No, he's
so
not.
Like,
he's not. It's the Me'arkan part. We're now returning the Jewish people from all over the world to Eretz Yisrael.
Well, wouldn't the order
that comes
be,
first.
Like, Israel's restored.
Judges, no, no. Jews come in. Look at the state of Israel today. Jews come in.
Jews
first
come
Aliyah,
five.
Second Aliyah. Right? You need Aliyah. Jews there. You build up the cities. Then you. Then we actually seen this. We saw this live. Then we see all the Aliyah come in. The Jews from the Middle East. Right? After the, before the Shoah. Okay, that's a process. It's not just a one-off thing.
I know, but then I'm still out of order.
1948, the Jewish land is established. Yes. Jews have come back. Then, God willing, we have a Sanhedrin
exactly,
will be built.
It's out of order. That's what I'm saying. We're in this long process part of, right now, we're in the Yerushalayim prayer. We're restoring Israel. But then
no, Yerushalayim is restoring Yerushalayim to be the seat of King David's kingdom.
Right.
Not just to live there, but also to restore the kingdom.
Saying, like, that's the first step in the process.
It's not the first step in the process. First of all, you're going to get Jews in.
Right. So
Jews in.
That would be like restoring it.
Jews
in.
It's not fully restored yet. We don't have full possession of the land of...
Do you not feel like this goes out of order, though?
This is the exact chronological order it's going to have before Mashiach comes.
So why would the shofar sound before the judges are
Because
restored?
The shofar sound is the return of the Jew from outside to the land of Israel.
So it's not... So
that's all it is.
So don't the judges have to come before that? That's a little...
No, because you can't have judges in Israel. There's no one in Israel. There's a sound of the shofar. The sound of the shofar over here refers to the sound of the Jewish people returning to Israel.
I thought that was like the moment.
Nope. There could be another shofar sound, but this is that one. Okay? Okay. So we ask Hashem to pray. Now, we prayed, we're asking Hashem to put a Shekhinah, Tishkom B'tach Yerushalayim, not just that we should be living in Yerushalayim, but we want the temple to be rebuilt in Yerushalayim, so Hashem Shekhinah is going to return there. Yeah.
I have a question about the Sanhedrin, like the judges and stuff. I think, I don't know if this is accurate because I don't really remember, but I think one of my rabbis in seminary said that he was asked to be appointed, like they were going to make a Sanhedrin and he was asked to like be on it. Like, are we allowed to
I think you misunderstood what he told you. There have been times in history, like Napoleon tried to do that, and Rav Steinsaltz attempted at some point to reestablish the Sanhedrin. It did not happen. They weren't able to do that at those times. I don't know your rabbi, maybe he's a great tzaddik, but that would be a very, very big position to be on. He would have to be like, you know.
Yeah.
A big and great holy rabbi. Which seminary is this?
The
top of the food chain.
They asked. Which rabbi is this? Rob Milstein asked to be on the Sanhedrin?
No, his name was Ari.
It could be. I mean, I'm sure he's a very holy, great rabbi.
Yeah.
Maybe there's a secret convention of Jews and rabbis are put together. Once again, I wasn't asked to be on it. Probably advisedly so. But I think he's talking about historically, but I think he himself was asked to be on the Sanhedrin. I doubt it. It could be. There have been attempts in history
to. But I'm
saying,
so how does that work? Like, are people just allowed to come together and be like, okay, let's.
Where it's a big deal. It's a big deal. Have to be with all the rabbis accepting it. Have to be accepted throughout the land of Israel, even Huslaritz. It's a big, big deal. Which why hasn't happened yet.
Right?
It's a big, big thing. Okay, fine. So now we have Yerushalayim is set up. And now we want the crown, which is Mashiach, et Tzemach David. So this is the reference to Mashiach. And this agricultural metaphor of Tzmichut is used, there's a number of metaphors used to describe Mashiach, but the agricultural one is one of them, of blossoming. Okay? Tzemach, Tzmichut. We ask Hashem to blossom. Why is that metaphor used? There's a few metaphors, by the way, that are used to describe Mashiach arrival, but this agricultural one is the famous one because the seed goes into the ground and it rots. And then eventually, very slowly, you see the new shoot, and then there's the branches, and there's the blossom, and then there's the fruit. It's a slow process, okay? And it's seeded. It's seeded from the days of David HaMelech right through history till his descendant, because by the way, one of the things that Mashiach is going to have to do is prove that he is a direct descendant. Funny, I was in someone's home on Sunday, a good friend of mine. He employed a very good genealogist, and he had a roll of paper that, I mean, went from that window to there, of just one side of his family, and he goes back to the Maharal of Prague. And the Maharal of Prague has a tradition that he comes from, Rashi, and we have a tradition that Rashi comes from Mashiach. And by the way, this gentleman even has, he did genetic testing on 23andMe, and I've never seen this before. He actually says, yeah, we see genetic material somehow on 23andMe. It says this of 2,000 years ago in Yerushalayim.
Oh, wow.
Pretty wild stuff, that.
Mrs. Schechter is also related to the Maharal.
Yeah, why not? What?
Mrs. Schechter is also related to the Maharal problem.
Wouldn't surprise me for a second.
But so.
My wife is as well. But I mean, the Maharal has got a lot of descendants at this point.
But so for the Davidic line, like for Mashiach,
yeah.
It has to come, it's his father's father's father, or could it be his mother's
father's father's father? Benacha, benacha, ben. Must come from the father's side.
Really?
In order to be Mashiach.
Why?
In order to be Mashiach. Because that's where we go.
Oh,
we go, tribes come through the father, Judaism comes through the mother. Okay? So we have Et Semach David Avtacha Mehira Tasmiach. You should blossom this thing, right? We want to see Mashiach coming because at the stage is set, everything's ready to go. The karno tarum. Now we mentioned over here a keren. What's a keren?
A
besides
horn.
My cousin, a horn. What is that a reference to?
The shofar,
the oil
strength.
Chatzrotrot are not of horn. They were actually metal. This is a keren. Is actually a term of power, of strength, and actually it was a keren that was used to anoint the Mashiach. Right? How do they anoint kings in history? They would take a keren, this horn, they would fill it with olive oil, and they would pour it, I don't hear, and they would pour it onto the head of the future king in the shape of a crown. Those people in my Mashiach class know about this. So that what it is referring to over here, right? But really it's referring to power, because the horn is the powerful part of the animal. So it refers to his strength, that he's going to be extremely strong individual. I don't think it means physically strong, but have tremendous power at his disposal in order to bring the Yeshua, the redemption. Okay? Ki lishvat kvinu kol hayom. We pray for Mashiach's arrival every single day. Do we? Do you pray for Mashiach's arrival every day? Yeah, we say the Amidah every day. And actually, that is one of the six questions the Gemara tells us. That every person is asked after they die. Tzipita l'Yeshua. Every day you have to look forward to the coming of Mashiach. Ilan, you're being very quiet today. You okay? You taking this all in?
Mm-hmm.
You should have a lot more from you. Okay. So this is all part of that praying to Hashem to bring the power of Mashiach in order to bring this Keren Yeshua.
What are the other five questions?
That's not for now. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
About like lineage.
Yeah.
How do you prove like people's lineage if their fathers like are converts or aren't Jewish?
Well, from that side of the family, you don't, because they're not Jewish from that side. You go through the mother's side, and if the mother is Jewish, they're Jewish.
What if your whole family converted? Like everyone was not.
Then fine. Then there's no lineage per se, but. Not only do you become part of the Jewish people, you take on the lineage of the Jewish people, which is why on Pesach, converts don't sit at Pesach saying, your ancestors were slaves in Egypt. You say, Avadim Hayinu, right? No, they weren't. We weren't slaves. My family weren't. Who knows? Maybe they were Egyptians during the year. But you become part of the national character of the entire Jewish people.
What's
so
tribe?
You take on full status of an entire Jewish people, but you don't need lineage to be Jewish. Right? You need lineage to be a king. You need lineage to be a Kohen, but you don't need lineage to be Jewish, which is why we accept converts.
Is that why
nation.
A Jew can't marry a convert?
A Jew can marry a convert.
My mom always told me that if a woman converted, she can't marry a Kohen.
Oh, Kohen cannot. That's another reason. Kohen cannot marry a convert. That's something else.
Is it the opposite way though? If like a man converted, can a woman who's like from a Kohen village?
A bat Kohen, yes, she can, I believe.
Okay,
so.
Okay, that doesn't matter in the same sense. But is that really a thing? Like,
yes, it's really a thing.
And what happens if they get
married? They're not allowed to do it. Their marriage is still a marriage, but it's not also. But you're getting off topic too much.
What tribe would a Jewish man, a Jewish convert?
Yehuda. but yeah, you'd be considered a regular Yisrael.
But I'm saying, like, say we did know. All of our say the tribes are still around. Like, would they be like automatically Yehuda?
Well,
or maybe like Levi, because Levi didn't really.
Where would they burn into? I'm not sure. I think there would be their choice potentially, except Levi. It would be their choice.
But
they
couldn't
be,
choose Levi.
Why can't we choose?
No, because Levi is from Cohen. You can't become a Cohen.
Oh.
You can't.
No, I feel like it would make sense because Levi doesn't necessarily have like a set place in Israel.
Reminds me of that joke. Was that joke of the guy who? He says, can you convert my dog? Is it convert my dog? And he says, convert your dog? You can't convert a dog. He's like, please, I'll pay $1 million. He goes, oh, he didn't tell me it was a Jewish dog or something.
His bark mitzvahs.
Okay, so we've asked Hashem to come. Now we ask Hashem, Shema Koleinu, hear our voices. Avarachamim, have mercy upon us. What's this doing over here? Why Shema Koleinu happened over here? What is Shema Kaleinu saying? Did anyone Shema Kaleinu a little bit earlier?
Oh.
Hear our voices from the beginning. What Shema Kaleinu doing over here? Stop and think. 1 second, Erica. Stop. Let's think. What is Shema Kaleinu doing over here? You don't have to read the answer. You can think as well. Yeah.
Well, because when Mashiach comes, that's not the end of history. There's still like.
So I think it's more than that. We'll have the Beit HaMikdash. And we know that our tefillot are listened even greater in Eretz Yisrael. But with the Beit HaMikdash, we have a direct line to Kadosh Baruch Hu. So I think that we're asking Hashem to not listen to our prayers right now, although that's obvious, but also to listen to our prayers then once Mashiach arrives in the third and final Beit HaMikdash put on Har HaBayit. We're like, hello, listen to our prayers. Yeah? But it also refers to our prayers right now, asking Hashem to accept all the prayers that we've made up to this point in the Amidah. Okay? Because you're the God who listens to all prayers. And then we say, Ritzeh. Hashem should be favorable to his people and to our prayers and return the Avodah, right? Return the service into the Beit HaMikdash. Right? And then we go to the third and final part of the Hashem Machzir Shekhinato L'Tzion. You should return the Shekhinah to Tzion. Tzion refers to, well, now refers to all of Israel, but really refers to Yerushalayim.
So
and
what's the third, first prayer of the final part? Sorry, it's the
Machzir Shekhinato L'Tzion.
Okay.
That's the final part of the Bakasha section.
Wait, which, sorry.
Hamachazir Shekhinato L'Tzion.
Okay.
And then we start modim. Modim.
Wait.
Hamachazir Shekhinato L'Tzion. Before modim. Yep.
So modim begins on praise.
Yeah.
Hodiah.
No.
Hodiah?
It's.
Isn't it the
Hoda'ah. Hoda'ah.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Shevach is praise.
Oh,
Hoda'ah
so
is
so
thanks.
Thanks. Sorry,
yeah.
I get a little confused.
Okay.
So now we're doing thanks.
You're welcome. And that's Moda. By the way, while the tefillah is being repeated, which is a big mitzvah to repeat, by the way, why do we repeat the Amidah at all? Why do we repeat the entire Amidah? Shachrit and Mincha, not Arvit, because Arvit Marav is not its own Korban. But why do we repeat
the
Amidah? Why do we do Chazara? Why is there Chazara? So two possibilities. One is, there's many people who don't know how to read at all. Yep. And therefore, they're being Yotzi by saying Baruch Hu V'Shamayim Amen. Another possibility, which is even more likely, is we may not have the correct Kavanah when we pray ourselves, when we had bad thoughts or we didn't, you know, do it properly. And so comes along the Chazara and is like, don't worry, we'll...
The Chazara is the Chazan?
No, Chazara is to repeat.
Oh.
The Shliach Tzibor is does Chazara. He repeats the entire Shemana Esrei, except this piece. Well, he actually does Modim, but we have this what's called Modim de Rabbanan. This little thing over here, by the way, the Chofetz Chaim says is a very, very special prayer. Very holy tefillah. This little Modim de Rabbanan.
It's only for rabbis?
It was made by the rabbis. Actually, all the tefillah was. But it's called the rabbinic thing. Why do we do this Modim de Rabbanan over here?
I didn't know it was supposed to. That was only for rabbis.
Yeah, no, it's for everyone.
Cool.
Not just rabbis.
Is it during a repetition?
Huh?
Isn't it during a repetition?
Yeah.
Oh, so why do we do that during...
Why does he do the entire repetition? And then... This speak we say ourselves. What's the answer to that?
I'm sorry, it is during the repetition?
The Shemoneh Esrei is repeated. While it's repeated, the Chazan, the Shlech Tzibor,
mm-hmm.
right, is going to say the regular Modim that we say during our personal Amidah. And then there's a little shaded box of thanks that we say. But why are we suddenly talking? The whole Amidah we kept quiet. And all of a sudden, hello, say this. I don't know the answer, but I did hear. I did hear that when it comes to thanks, you can only say it yourself, right?
You can what?
You should say it yourself. Thanks to someone else. My friend wants to say thank you. Well, your friends say thank you, then what are you thanking me for? They know where I live. They got my number. So when it comes to thanks, you got to say it yourself. I've never seen that written anywhere, but I've heard it in the names of great people, so I believe that to be true.
So point of the Rabbi Modim to like thank our rabbis, essentially?
No. It is a thank. We'll have a look at it. Read the words, right? The grateful thank you, you, capital Y, to Hashem. You should have an English Hebrew support.
I have one at home in my apartment. It's big.
No problem. Right? God of our fathers, right? We thank our God of Baruch Hu. It's just, even when you give like a thanks to Hashem, it's got to be personal. Right? You can't thank Hashem for.
Wait, so do you say Modim de Rabbanan after you say Modim?
No.
So this
when
is
you
only
read you when you read the Amidah, I mean, you say the big one.
Yeah.
The regular one. When it's repeated, the Chazan will say the big one and you say the mini one.
So we can't just read that in our own
you do not.
Okay.
Only during the Shliach Tzibor's Chazara.
Rabbi, can I write in my Sidur?
Yes, you can.
Like, okay.
Yes, you can. Someone else did it as well. All this stuff's at the bottom. Written. You can add your own little notes in there. Yeah. And that's why we have the thanks. They put the Al Nisim for Purim. And Hanukkah, they added it over here. Okay? Because we're grateful for the redemption of Purim and Hanukkah. So it makes sense that that would be the location for that. And we thank Hashem for all the good. Okay?
Yeah, but I didn't realize the first 2 days of Hanukkah that that was there.
And then we finished.
I panicked in the middle of Shemoneh Esrei one day, and I was like, if I've been messing
you don't
up,
need to, if you
don't need to repeat it.
You don't need to repeat
going,
it.
No. Yeah, but I
and
said
then
that.
Finally, we end up with the greatest bracha, because you finish it. Sof ma'aseh, b'mash v'tchila. We ask Hashem for shalom, and the shalom obviously comes at the end of the Amidah, okay? And we ask Hashem for our shalom for ourselves, for our people, for our nation, for our country, the entire world. So it finishes with shalom. Then you'll say the final bracha, Bavarech Atam Yisrael B'Shalom, Amen. Really, that's the official end of the Amidah. Okay? And when you say the Yul Rotzon, that finishes it, that closes it off. And that extra bracha afterwards, or the extra tefillah, it's not really a bracha, there's no bracha in it. The Elokai Netzor is really not part of the official Amidah. It was added, that's why you have slightly different versions of it amongst Sfarim and Ashkenazim. But really, once the Yirat Zon, I mean, it's finished. And according to most opinions, you can even, if you're at that point, you said that first Yirat Zon, you can answer Kedusha. You can answer Kedusha, although you haven't taken three steps back, according to most opinions. Okay? But besides that, you probably shouldn't answer anything else. You say this final prayer, this final tefillin or prayer, yeah? And then we said you'll finish before the second Il Rosson. You will say your name verses we spoke about, okay, which you should have at this point, and you should have your personal requests.
Yeah,
then
I
you say
that.
The second Il Rosson, and at that point, to say that even if you haven't stepped back yet, you can answer all tefillah. You can answer Modim, Kaddish, whatever you want. Really, that's done. And then you take three steps back, which I told you how to do. The Amidah is officially finished. Yes.
How come the Shalom Bracha is different?
It is a Fisfardim. I know.